Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Effective Communication with Victims of Sexual Assault. I'm Alex Parati. Real quick, some administrative notes. If you need a CEU of any type, please email us at webinars@taasa.org with the title of this class and the date you attended, and we will email you a CEU. Be advised that for CEUs, you must attend for at least 60 minutes, and you must complete an evaluation. We'll try and answer questions as they go on. Please just type them into the chat box, and we'll try and answer them. If we miss your question, we will come back at the end and have an open discussion and talk about any questions you may have or clarification. I'm also joined here with Kim Farbo.
Hi, good morning.
Kim, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
So I'm pretty new to TAASA. I started here in September. However, I am retired from the Austin Police Department. I spent 24 years there, and the last 12 to 13 years I spent in sex crimes. And in sex crimes at Austin PD, we investigated adult crimes only. Anything that had a sexual connotation, crime, meaning to it, came across our desk. So we investigated misdemeanor crimes from window peeping and indecent exposures to sexual assaults of all kinds. So I retired in 2010 and just started with TAASA, hoping that I can share my experience and help any way I can.
And I'm Alex Parati. I've been here at TAASA for about a year and a half. Before that, I was in the U.S. military. I did unconventional warfare and worked in Latin America doing counter-human trafficking. A lot of my experience was conducting interviews with trafficking victims and certain points throughout Central America, getting a lot of human intelligence, working that aspect. And then I came over to TAASA, and now I work with local, state, and federal law enforcement on all aspects of sexual assault, but I am a human trafficking specialist, so that is definitely my focus. And so my background, really a lot of different types of interviews, and we do technical assistance, especially with Homeland Security investigations and FBI on interviewing techniques and doing technical assistance to assist them with working with victims and how to conduct interviews with victims. So we're going to go ahead and get started. Thank you very much for attending. We had a full registration, 200 people registered. One of the things we were probably going to do, because I received a lot of, seems like there's a big need for this type of course, we'll probably offer it again next month, something similar. So if you see it posted again, it's going to be the same class. It's just going to be for people who were unable to attend this one. So if you see it, please don't register for it, because we want to allow as many people as possible to attend. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. Here's our agenda for today. We're going to start looking at trauma. We're not going to go into the neurobiology of trauma and all the science aspect of it. We're just going to quickly touch on trauma, because that is the basis of our interviewing techniques. So we're going to go over the fundamentals of interviewing. We're going to talk about proxemics and neurolinguistics, a little bit about body language, and what type of environment your interview should be in. We're going to look at interviewing specific techniques. We're going to look at the forensic experiential trauma interview that was developed by Russell Strand, who is with the military police for the U.S. Army, and he's in their behavioral department. And then we're going to look at, and pass it off to Kim, and Kim's going to look at law enforcement specific interviewing and specific steps, and then we'll go ahead and conclude and have a discussion and answer any questions that you may have. So we're going to kind of look at all these different aspects of interviewing. And really the thing is to point out is each situation is different. Each experience of a victim is different. These are things that, although this is law enforcement centered, I think anybody who is working with victims can learn something from this webinar. This is something to put in your toolkit. Think about these different aspects. Try them out. I would say if you feel uncomfortable with anything we're talking about and you don't feel like that's something you want to try, maybe practice it with an assistant and see how it goes. I know a lot of times before we would go out and conduct interviews, and even now when we do interviews with victims, what we'll do is we'll plan ahead, come up with an idea of what we want to try, and then if it's something new, we'll practice it on each other, and somebody can say, yeah, I see what you were trying to do there, but that was a little weird. Why don't you try this aspect? So, you got to be humble about it. Interviews, especially when you're first starting, are not easy. I know when I first started doing interviewing, I wish I knew the trauma-informed approach, because that would have made it a lot easier. But without further ado, we're going to get started. We're going to watch this video real quick. I think everybody enjoy it. Now, the audio is a little weird because the way our system's set up, but I'll do the best I can.
You guys want some water or tea?
You seem pretty upbeat for somebody who just had their computer stolen.
Well, I've just never been robbed before. I'm just trying to be polite.
Are you sure it wasn't an unfortunate yard sale?
Yeah, it was a brand new iMac with Retina display.
Sounds pretty sexy. Are you flaunting it?
No, it was right over there on the bureau.
Oh, right in front of this window. Flashing your goods for all the world to see? Kind of sounds like you were asking for it.
I should be able to put my computer wherever I want.
By filing a report, you're going to bring a lot of negative attention to this neighborhood and to yourself.
I don't care. It's not my fault that this happened. The perpetrator should be the one getting the negative attention.
Whoa, are you yelling at us? Because that is exactly the kind of bad behavior that we can use against you in your report.
No, I'm sorry. I'm not yelling. Please investigate.
Sure. Would you take a look around? No signs of forced entry.
Nope.
Locks intact.
Yep.
No broken windows. Do you have any physical evidence that you were robbed?
Yes. I had a computer, and now I don't have a computer.
Oh, let's not get cute, okay? How do I know that you didn't want someone to take your computer?
Because I'm saying I didn't.
Had you been drinking?
I had a Bloody Mary at brunch, but I don't see why that matters.
Wow. Because if you were drinking, the courts are probably going to side with the robber.
That doesn't make any sense. Even if I was blackout drunk, I'd still have the right to a safe home.
I think we're done here.
Wait, what?
Well, we need physical evidence in order to prove that you were robbed, and so far, we don't have any.
Well, what about dusting for fingerprints?
We could dust for fingerprints.
Great, yeah, let's do that.
But there is a backlog of 400,000 fingerprint kits that have yet to be processed, so it's going to be a while.
This is ridiculous.
And even if we did find the perp at this point, it would be a real he said thing.
What?
Yeah, so you ready to drop this thing?
Yeah. No, absolutely not. Someone was in here without my consent, and they took something that I'll never get back. I feel violated. And by not doing something about it, you're letting him go free so he can do it to other people.
Look, we can tell you're upset. So we're going to file a report. Don't worry. If I was you, I'd maybe get an alarm system, some security cameras, keep your blinds closed, hide all your valuables.
Buy yourself a gun, take some self-defense classes, make sure you get a big dog, make sure the house is never alone.
God, this whole system is set up against the victims.
Hey, robbers will be robbers. I'd like that tea now.
No, there's no tea.
Oh, water would be great.
I hope everybody was able to hear the video. It's a funny video, but the point is real. When conducting these interviews, you can't conduct them like you would a stolen car or something like that, right? So this is something that is a life-changing event for the victim, and so we need to take into account the trauma and what they've experienced and weave it into the way we conduct our interview. So real quick, we'll touch on what trauma is. So it's any event outside the range of usual human experience, and these type of events that threaten or destroy what they believe in. So it's something that trauma is something that occurs when somebody is under extreme fear, or somebody they trust, like in a non-stranger rape, violates that trust and puts them through this type of experience. So when we talk about what trauma-informed care is, the key points to take away from this is, you know, we talk about listening and hearing the lived experience of a victim or survivor, but the key point is to create a safe environment, to listen, and understanding that trauma does affect the brain. And as we'll look, a lot of the things that used to be thought about what an interview was has changed. And we understand now with trauma and trauma-informed interviewing techniques, we're better able to assist victims through this process. One of the things we talk about trauma, one doctor was relating it to, they're writing down a bunch of notes on Post-it notes and putting it on a desk, and so they have a whole desk full of Post-it notes, and then they're trying to put it all back together, and you're trying to get that information. So everything is separated and it's not in order, and so it's very difficult to conduct an interview of this type. And so we need to take that into aspect when conducting interviews with victims of sexual assault. So as we look at the circle of care and trauma-informed care, one of the main things we look at here is going to be the communicate with compassion, understand the prevalence of the impact of trauma, promoting safety. You know, trust is safety. So we earn trust with the victim. You're creating a safe environment where they can feel free to communicate with you, and you elicit that free narrative, which is where you're going to get the truth. So, you know, some aspects that we use, you know, is described as, you know, disclosure from a victim. Disclosure is not a process. It's a process. It's not an event. It's not something that just happens. It takes time, and it takes finesse on the interviewer's part to create this environment to elicit a free narrative. Some aspects include, you know, asking the same type of questions but in many different ways, kind of like the old psychological test, because different way it's framed, different people react to it, and you're able to get as much information as you can in a safe environment that's comfortable for the victim. And the goal is to capture this type of event and understand it. So when interviewing a victim and being trauma-informed, we know that the victim may not recall pertinent details. A big aspect of that is, you know, certain things may be really, really important to them and have a special meaning to them, but aren't necessarily important for a criminal justice interview. So they might be focused on one thing and keep on bringing up something over and over again, and your job is to acknowledge that and try and understand the meaning of that. But, you know, when in an interview, because it is the majority of the victim speaking, you know, guiding them to the information that you need for your investigation, but not pushing for information that they cannot give. The other thing is understanding that, you know, if it's early on, they may be too emotional to make a statement, or they may, you know, start off speaking very clearly, but something triggers them, and they degrade to a point where they can no longer continue. And it's okay to take breaks and take your time. This is one of those things that being patient and disciplined is going to be extremely important when conducting an interview. And like we said, with the Post-it notes, they may not organize information in a chronological order. So one of the things we look at is creating benchmarks. One of the organizations that do the recovery of hostages, one of the main things they do during their multi-sessional forensic interview is to get key points that are important to that victim and use them as a benchmark. So if, the victim went into the bedroom or went upstairs, there's a bookmark. Place that bookmark and then use it and understand, did it happen before this or after this? Before you went upstairs or did it happen, after you went upstairs? And understanding that. Then once you have those benchmarks and you have those there, you can kind of piece together things and create a timeline in a chronological order that is easier to understand. And understanding that those bookmarks are not things you want as a bookmark. That bookmark is what is important to the victim, that key point that in their mind they understand and know that is going to be something that they're going to remember for sure, and you can place it in there as a benchmark and understand when and where that occurred. Overall, we understand that what a victim says comes from their observations, what they see, what they hear, what's happening to them at that time. And then how they perceive everything and their interpretation of what is going on, that fear, the emotions that are going on. And then finally, their conclusion. Based on their circumstances, what it means to them and their background, they come up with their conclusions. And that's what you're getting, is what they have gone through this process of observation and they interpret it. And then this is their conclusion, and they're giving you that information. I think it's extremely important to understand that everybody's going to react differently to this type of experience. So, people may be, obviously very emotional, but they also might laugh or joke or make light of the situation. But that isn't anything that is unusual. That is a defense mechanism. So you can't use what you've previously learned of, how a person should act or signs of deception, because trauma affects everybody differently. And so understanding that, the stuff you learn at the academy, the interviewing books you look at, body language books, a lot of that doesn't apply to this because of trauma. And we'll get into more specifics about that. And also, the person may be controlled. They may be totally stoic, in control of everything, very calm, and just tell you kind of matter of fact, this is what happened. But it doesn't mean that it's not affecting them. It doesn't mean that it wasn't a big deal to them. That's just the frame of mind they're in. And both of those are defense mechanisms to protect themselves, because it's a very difficult subject to talk about. I mean, for example, if you went into a classroom and said, who wants to tell me about their last sexual encounter? Well, no, a lot of people are going to say, no, I don't want to talk about that. Now it's not consensual, or it was with force and fear. That's even harder to relay that information. It's extremely difficult for a victim, and we need to acknowledge that from the get-go before you even walk into that room. And I think if you're extremely experienced with working with victims or you're brand new, it's always good to remind yourself that, because this is not routine. This is not routine. Even though you might deal with this a lot and you work with victims a lot, you got to keep yourself in that frame of mind that this is an extreme event to that individual, and it's affecting their way of life and it's changed them forever. And so it's a long journey from being a victim to becoming a survivor and healing. So it's nothing to take light, and you need to take account of that when conducting an interview. So here's a quote from a law enforcement publication from 1995. Generally, the actions and the appearance of a, quote, legitimate rape victim leave little doubt that a crime has been committed. And then it goes on to describe that it should be highly agitated and emotionally distraught, and, there should be injuries. Wow, I mean, we've come a long way from this, but this is the basis. And a lot of this still exists. These ideas still exist in people's minds that this is how somebody should act after they are sexually assaulted or raped. They need to act this way, and if they don't act this way, well, then they're lying to you. And so we're going to really break this down and go into, you know, what we think about a regular crime or regular interview is going to be much different than the way that we conduct an interview with a sexual assault victim. So we look at this publication and think, wow, this is outdated, it's crazy. And just understand that, of course, trauma affects everybody differently. And we look at this and understand that some of our assumptions with other type of individuals that we interview do not apply here and can lead to false signs of deception. So you might think, oh, this person might be deceptive, but it's affecting them in their unique way. It's unique scenario. Everyone is different. And the way it affects each person is going to be unique to them, and understanding that. So, what is an interview? It's to gather information. It's to get the truth. It's not an interrogation. You aren't challenging this person. You're not intimidating this person. You're making a calm, safe environment. It's very passive, and it's, you know, it's slow. It takes a lot of finesse and time and patience. It's not suggestive. Nothing that's going to happen. You're not telling them or leading them with any type of questions. Doesn't require a lot of direct input. Really, all the questions that you are going to ask is going to be specifically for guiding this interview and clarifying information. So understanding it's a free-flowing conversation, and it's set with a pace set by the victim. It's really their interview. Sometimes, you know, it can occur on site, but it's better to have it occur at a comfortable location. If you're working in a certain area, like in law enforcement, you want to ensure that you're not using the same room you're doing interrogations as the same room you're doing your interview. So make it very relaxed and comfortable. The main thing is the more relaxed and comfortable the victim is, the more information they're going to give you. And that's what that's the goal of this. So you don't want to do anything that's going to make them feel uncomfortable. We'll look at proxemics. Now, proxemics are created with four types of distances. One is intimate distance, personal distance, social distance, and public distance. So the public distance that's way too far away. You're not going to engage somebody from that distance, and even the social distance. It's very formal. It's standoffish. It's very protective. And you're not really going to make that person comfortable. But at the same time, you don't want to be in the intimate distance. Like with interrogations, you start off at a personal distance, and then when you're trying to get information or have somebody crack, you move into the intimate distance, which is less than 18 inches. And that's very intimidating, and it's dominating. So the main thing to do is understand that, you know, it's not a hard set, 18 inches to 4 feet, but generally that's the right thing. Personal distance. It shows that it's casual, it's not intimidating, it's not overly formal, and it demonstrates that you are comfortable, you are engaged, you are listening, but you're not disinterested either. And if you're far away and you're leaning back in your seat, those are all things that kind of show that you're not very interested. And you don't really care about the interview. So those are things to keep in mind. The next thing we're going to talk about is neurolinguistics. So one of the common things is, you know, if the victim's sitting, you shouldn't be standing. We see a lot of this, especially with our trafficking victims. officers will pull over an individual. There's a victim. They have the victim sit on the curb, and they're standing. They're all standing around that victim. One time we were doing an operation here in Texas, and he's talking to this victim that's a minor, and he's standing way too close to her and totally towering over her, and his crotch is like, 18 inches from her face. So, obviously he wasn't doing it intentional, but you have to be aware of what your body language is, and that's really key. Don't forget about how you in law enforcement and investigators, a lot of times you're looking at how that person that you're interviewing or interrogating, what their body language is. But here it's reversed. You need to be really cognizant of what your body language is, because that's what's going to make the other person, the victim, and or the interviewee, very uncomfortable. You know, one of the things is, a lot of times, especially understanding that as a law enforcement or even a care provider doing direct services, you're in a position of power right off the bat. And a lot of those victims, and you'll see this if you're talking to somebody, will mirror your body language. And one of the things we found out was when that the interviewer was starting to get uncomfortable or crossing their arms, or they weren't really paying attention to what they were doing, well, then the victim would do the same thing. And then all of a sudden they're feeling uncomfortable, and you've kind of lost the dynamic that you wanted as being a more of a dominating presence in that interview room. So understand your body language. Open posture is going to be key. If you are standing and conducting an interview and they are standing, if you're 6'5", don't be too close to them. Increase your distance so you're not intimidating to them. I learned that the hard way. I'm 6'4", and we were doing interviews in Latin America, and I was always towering over people, and it took me a while to figure that out until I saw a picture of one of my interviews, and I look like I'm twice the size of the person I was interviewing, so that's got to be pretty intimidating for them. So, changed our tactics on that. Taking notes. This is kind of a tricky subject. If you have the ability to record, then great. But, a lot of times we notice when we're working with some of the federal agents is, they'll be taking notes, but when the person is relaying this information, what is important to them and what is important to the criminal justice system when you're taking notes is different. So for a lot of times we had victims feel like, I just told him something really heavy and deep, and he didn't take any notes. Then I made some comment that was of no significance to me, and all of a sudden he's taking a bunch of notes. So you kind of have that, when is this guy taking notes? What's not important? Similar to when you're in school and you have the teacher's got a red pen and you're doing a presentation, and every time that red pen comes out, you're getting a bad mark. And then what happens? People are up giving that presentation, all of a sudden they're freezing and thinking and questioning themselves of what they're doing. And this happens when taking notes. I know it doesn't seem like a big deal, but that's just one of those things that, understanding this will aid you in becoming a better interviewer. This is really geared more towards law enforcement, but removing sunglasses when you're conducting the interview. So if you're out there and conducting an interview, having the big sunglasses and crossed arms, those are all things that make you look like a robot. I think it's extremely important that as a interviewer is to humanize yourself. You're not just law enforcement. You're not just somebody doing your job. You're a human. You're a person, and that leads into exuding a genuine concern for that victim. We want to also ensure that we maintain full attention towards the victim. Your attention is directed towards the victim. You shouldn't be checking your radio or doing something else or looking at your phone. Everything is going to be towards the victim. An open body position, And we'll kind of talk about how to position yourself here in a minute. So now we talk about body language. You know, we talk about body language, these aspects that, and if you read books about body language, they have, you know, this is what this person means and this is what they're doing. And we're going to look here in a second and kind of break this down and know that a lot of the things that we thought or were taught do not apply when conducting an interview with a victim. So I'm going to show this quick video. This is by Russell Strand, which we'll really get into later, but he's got some good points here.
What we've learned is that deception detection is actually deceptive. When victims are acting naturally based on stress, they look guilty. Some of the things we think guilty people do are this. The initial research showed that when you're lying, it takes a lot of cognitive ability and energy. The problem is a trauma victim is under the same cognitive load that we perceive as somebody that's lying is under. Trauma victims, much like child abuse victims, are also susceptible to suggestion. Quite frankly, most of us are no better at detecting deception, even us trained professionals, than flipping a coin.
Yeah, I think he hits all the main points there, is they're also open to suggestion. So asking any leading questions or pushing them in one direction or the other, they're going to follow your lead. They're going to tell you what they think you want to hear rather than giving you the truth. So it's really important to understand that aspect. I see that there's a comment on the chat box saying, you know, I was told that I did not behave like a rape victim because I froze during my assault. And one of the huge things we talk about with law enforcement is tonic immobility. And we'll get into specifically, you know, when victims say, hey, I froze, or I couldn't move, or I couldn't do anything. And a recent report came out in 2015 that showed that almost half of all rape victims show at one point tonic immobility, where they are unable to move or do anything. And so that's why during these interviews we've got to be very careful and avoid these why questions of why didn't you do this and why didn't you do that, and you know, that accusatory, because tonic immobility is a thing. It's proven, and it's, you know, we didn't used to think it was occurred that much, but now it's almost 50% with the better statistics we have now. So those are the things to take into account. It's huge. So you don't want to treat a victim or say they didn't behave the way they should, you know, because everybody acts differently. And tonic immobility is extremely common. It's a defense mechanism that is induced in extreme fear situations. It's a survival mechanism. Real quick on that is, you know, we have the fight or flight, but the third one now is freeze. Fight, flight, freeze. So I think it's very important that especially law enforcement understands that. So we're going to look at some of the key things that always pop up, especially when we're working with federal law enforcement, where they go, I don't know if she was telling the truth or this or that because of, or I was reading her body language. So the partial arm barrier, typically in law enforcement, we see it as a sign of closure, protection. They're afraid of what's happening. They're trying to conceal something from the interviewer. But really, it's a consoling posture. It's to comfort themselves. It's attempt to regain control and composure, because you know, if they're telling you something that is very intimate, it's something that induced a lot of fear, and now they're trying to comfort themselves, and now they have to explain and relive this experience and tell it to a stranger. So, I mean, extremely difficult. You know, the arm cross, you know, we always see that as being defiant or attempting to hide information, and they're, you know, don't want anything to do there. the same thing like we talked about before, protection, trying to become smaller and regain some sense of control and to comfort themselves. And the reason we go through these specifically is because people go, okay, yeah, I got it. Body language doesn't work during a trauma interview. And then they go, but it, you know, when it comes to crossed arms, that's definitely a sign of deception. So we're going to make sure we hit all of these real quick because I think it's an important aspect. Agitation. This isn't, you know, I heard one law enforcement individual tell me, you know, the sign of agitation was, you know, they made a false accusation and now they see the gravity of it. So now they're biting their nails and they're upset. But, you know, that's not true. They're dealing with trauma. They're trying to cope with what is going on. And it's what they do. When they feel like they don't have any control because they're doing the interview, everybody else is telling them what to do, they're in the system, it's difficult. They're the victim. They had a lot taken away from them, and they weren't in control during this event. And when they're reliving it, yeah, they're fearful. And then just going through the criminal justice process is very scary. It's a scary thing for anybody, especially when you're talking about a sexual assault. The intersecting hands and ankle lock. You know, typically this is a sign of denial, deny accusations, but really the victim, you'll see a lot. We see this often during interviews, especially when we're recording them, is you know them protecting their groin area, a closed posture, attempt to look smaller. They feel helpless, and that's what this means. So real quick, let's talk about a sitting interview. Big thing is a lot of times we see interviews sitting across from a victim. That is a little bit more accusatory, it's defensive, it's not super comfortable. So we look at the corner position, which is the one on the left. It's your body's open, you're still facing them, but it gives the victim the opportunity to take a break and look away. And focus on something else on the wall. And that's extremely common. So just given that, instead of you taking them on head on and grilling them about what's going on, so the corner position is most ideal for sitting interviews. And once again, in an area that is not used for interrogation, conference room, an office, anything like that is better than bringing them inside a facility like that. So preparing for the interview, I know that a lot of times you're going to an interview and you don't know who your victim is, but it's important to have a plan in your head, of generally a sexual assault, right? Understanding that sexual assault is a life-changing event, like we talked about. Prepare to see an array of emotions and understanding that sexual assault is a unique crime. We talk about re-traumatization and triggers. When you're guiding the interview and they start describing things, we try to avoid re-traumatization and avoid triggers, but it's okay to understand that sometimes this will occur and it may be unavoidable. But just understanding that that may be a thing. So when it does occur, take a break, get some water, get a snack. Kleenex to when they're crying, and then understanding complex trauma also. So your interview tone and behavior, like we said, safe and neutral environment, offer small choices. Do you want a water or Gatorade? Yeah, I want a Gatorade. Okay, what color of Gatorade do you want? So they're regaining control. I know it sounds like a small thing, but it's a big thing to them, especially when they're talking to law enforcement. It is so important, and a lot of times people forget this, introduce yourself and explain your role in a sexual assault investigation. I am Detective Blank. I work in sex crimes. This is what I do. This is what I, and then tell them your goal. This is what I'm here today to listen to you and understand what happened to you and gather as much information as I can for my investigation. It is very important to build that framework of, this is who I am. I'm here for you. This is the goal. We'll work together. It's always good to say, bring it up as if we're a team. We're working together. I'm not an outside person just getting information, and this is my job, and I work, you know, these hours. You know, genuine concern. This is who I am. We're going to get through this. We're going to work as a team. If you need anything, let me know. So you build rapport with the victim. Ask them questions at the beginning that have nothing to do about a sexual assault. What school do you go to? Where are you from? What do you do? You know, all those type of things. And then it's okay to talk about yourself because it humanizes yourself. You're a person. You're not just a guy in a uniform or in a suit conducting an interview. And understand the power you hold as an interviewer. You are in a position of power, whether you're law enforcement or direct services. Avoid using words that are accusatory or cast out. A lot of times people say, allegedly this happened, or so you're stating this. Well, no, she's not stating that. She's telling you what happened to her. It's not your job to cast doubt on what they're doing by saying stating. And then once again, understand your body language and assess the comfort of the victim. If they start feeling uncomfortable, take a break. And then slowly work yourself back into the interview. And then, like we talked about, taking notes. Key is to demonstrate empathy, but remain neutral. Be aware of your speed of delivery. If you're talking real fast, it seems like you're rushing the interview. If you're you're very slow and a lot of ums and all right, I guess, then what happened? That shows that you don't care and you don't know what you're doing. Always important to review the information with the victim and clarify. It's okay to say, wait, I don't understand something. Can we go back and talk about this or that? All right? One of the things that people always forget, ask the victim at the end if they have any questions, because I guarantee you they do. What's going to happen next is going to be the biggest question you're going to get. Refer them to services and then inform the victim of what the process is, and then finish up with them. So let them know. Typically we say we give them three things that are going to happen next, and usually it's written down. Here are the three things. Tomorrow somebody's going to contact you from blank office, then this is going to happen, then that's going to happen, and then write it down and give it to them, okay, because they're not going to remember as soon as they walk out of the office. But it's really important to make them feel comfortable in this process and throughout it and being in communication with them. So, you know, listening is a skill, and it's an art. It does demand a lot of things from the interviewer. You need to have a plan, a lot of concentration, being professional, understanding a lot of aspects, your body language, their body language, what they're telling you, what it means. But the main thing is listening gives us information, and it doesn't require talk back or for you to disagree. You're just there to guide the interview and clarify, because this is where you get the truth. The do not promise anything. You never know what's absolutely going to happen. So promising anything is the worst thing you could do, because if it doesn't happen, hey, this person, I promise, will call you tomorrow, and that person calls in sick and they don't make that phone call, then that person that trusted you, you've let down. And trust is not refillable. Once you lose that trust, you're done. You're not going to get that back. And you're probably going to have to pass off future interviews to somebody else. Of course, do not judge the victim or ask why they did or do not do something. Well, why did you get in his car? Why didn't you fight back? No, that does not work. Worst thing you could do. Offer unsolicited advice. What you need to do is this. Then you should do that. They don't need somebody barking orders at them and telling them what to do. Another big one, huge, minimizing the victim's experience. For example, non-stranger. Oh, well, they were dating for a while, and then he came back. It's, you know, that's not a big deal. No, because that was somebody you once loved or cared about that betrayed your trust and did something violent to you. So it makes the individual question, like, well, I trusted this person. Who can I trust? What is my judgment? I must not have good judgment. They're questioning everything. So you need to understand that aspect. And then the time. Delayed reporting happens all the time because they're dealing with a lot of trauma and trying to understand, oh, my God, what just happened to me? So it's don't ask questions like, well, why'd you wait a week or a month to tell me what was going on? And then once again, cast doubt or challenge a statement made by the victim. Using legal language or slang, don't assume people know what you're talking about. And it sounds, you know, you don't want to sound like a robot. Like we said, rush the interview, scan away from the big victim. Huge one I see a lot is pass off the interview when it's not appropriate. I'm a guy doing the interview. I don't really like doing these interviews, so I'm going to pass it off to a female because that's the female. She does all the interviews for this. I don't want to do it. Well, that's going to be really, really uncomfortable. The other thing is indicating that you are uncomfortable, showing the victim that I don't feel comfortable listening to what you're telling me. Well, guess what? They're going to shut down. And once a victim shuts down, it's going to be hell to try and have them open back up with anybody. So not only did you screw that interview for yourself, you probably screwed that interview with your partner or whoever else is going to come in on that. We're going to watch this video on Russ Duran, who's going to talk about the forensic experiential trauma interview. Just different idea of conducting an interview.
The forensic experiential trauma interview. The purpose is to collect as much of the forensic psychophysiological evidence as possible. The first step is genuine empathy. Victims should never be treated as witnesses to their own crime. The second step is this question. Help me understand what you're able to remember about your experience. Hear those two words, able and experience. And then the third step is shut your mouth and open your ears and listen. What we're trying to do is far bigger than the military. What we're doing with the FETI impacts all of our society.
So the FETI, what it looks like is there's some key points. You know, what are you able to tell me about your experience? Tell me more about this. Help me understand. What were you feeling? What was your thought process during this experience? And we're going to break these down here in a second. What are you able to remember about? And then that whole idea of talking about sight, sound, smell, taste, touch. And then, you know, physical reactions, what was the most difficult part of this experience for you? What can't you forget about this experience? And then clarifying the information and details after you facilitate all you can about their experience. So, you know, once again, this is trauma-informed, and trust is going to be huge. Trust is huge. So we'll break down, I think, the key points from this. We're not going to go down each one. We're just going to hit the key major points of the FETI. So first thing you're going to do is acknowledge the victim's trauma and pain. Like we said, you need to demonstrate empathy. You need to be patient when working with a victim and understanding. Take time to build rapport and build trust, because trust is safety, and that's something that was taken away from them. So if you're able to create an environment where you humanize yourself and they trust you, then you are able to create a safe environment, and the safer and comfortable they feel, they're going to invite you into what Russell Strand calls the trauma bubble. That is where they have compartmentalized this extreme event that has occurred to them. And if you're unable to get in that bubble, you're not going to get the information you need. The next one is ask the victim what they are able to remember about their experience. So, like Russell said, the key words are able and experience. Able relieves pressure on the victim. It's okay that you don't remember something or you can't answer one of my questions. That's okay. I understand. Tell me what you are able to tell me. What can you remember about this? And then it's not only the word experience, but it's their experience. They lived it, and it has an extreme meaning to them, and each aspect of it is their own interpretation of it. So this demonstrates that it is unique to them, and it's not their responsibility during this interview to identify what is important for the interview. So it's allowing them to really explore themselves and relay information about their experience, and it's not up to them to know, well, you're a detective and this is the information you need to know. Therefore, you're able to elicit a free narrative that best describes the scenario and the circumstances before, during, and after the assault. Ask the victim about their thought process at certain points. This is huge. This is because this eliminates the why questions, the victim blaming, re-victimization of this individual. Why didn't you fight back? Why didn't you scream? Why didn't you run? Why did you go with him? Why did you go upstairs? All those questions. It's better to ask that victim, you know, what was going through your head at this point? And they're able to tell you. It demonstrates their reasons for certain actions or inactions. And once again, we talk about tonic immobility. Okay? I froze. I didn't know. I thought he was going to kill me. Right? I didn't know what to do. Boom. Now you know it's tonic immobility, and you're able to understand that. You know, if you were not experienced in any of this, you would look fast and go, oh, she didn't fight back. Well, that's weird. So that's why it's key to understand these aspects, and especially tonic immobility. Also, when you ask them about their thought process, it brings them back, and they're thinking about how they felt when something happened. What was their state of mind? And through that, they're able to recall more information. It'll elicit more information, and they will activate different parts of their brain during that because they're putting themselves back in that situation. Understand, that may re-traumatize them. There's probably going to be some triggers in there. But, you know, take your time, allow breaks, but the information is going to be pertinent for your investigation. And then the other thing is to ask about tactile memories, such as sounds, sights, smells, and feelings before, during, and after the incident. Russell Strand calls this the most important part of FETI because it increases the ability to relate to the experience. You know, what did you hear? What did you see? Maybe it smelled like cigarettes or alcohol. The TV was on in the background. I saw this or that. Then, once again, it does put them back in that situation, but they're able to recall more information that they forgot because they're really accessing different parts of their brain, and able to recall certain details. And as they recall the certain details, once the details start coming, more and more will come. And sensory information can actually become important in investigations and during prosecution. We had a case in Houston where a female victim was being sexually assaulted, and so she was constantly looking away from the perpetrator and noticed a figurine. They, law enforcement put it in their report and said, all right, but what ended up happening was that figurine was from another sexual assault. That guy had raped somebody else. Also, it kind of, when you're working with juries in the prosecution, it shows that those details help the jury better understand the situation that's going on. And so there's many reasons why asking about those is very important. But the main reason is because of their ability to recall certain information. The other one is to ask the interviewee how this experience affected them physically and emotionally. It increases the understanding of the context of the experience, how they how they feel now. And this is before, during, and after the assault. This also, the victim will display emotions. So those physiological and physical reactions should be documented. Document these reactions because this will assist in the forensic evidence. And then the interviewer should clarify other information and details. And we've brought this up many times, but so memory encoding during a traumatic event is unique because of that fight, flight, freeze. The way it compartmentalizes that information is different. So some of the information may be out of order, some of it may be, different than their original statement. That's okay. Just to clarify that and just ask them a question without casting doubt on it. And the central details are perceived as essential to survival and self-defense. So when this event is occurring to them, they have that survival mode, so that's the type of information that they can recall most easily. So it's exploring that area. And then the key thing is to go over in a chronological order to make sure your understanding is congruent with the victim's circumstances. So go back through your notes, and from start to finish, this is what I understand, this is what was going through your head when this happened, this is where you were, going over all of that. And then finally, closing with, is there anything you would like to add? Is there anything I should know? Or anything you just want to share with me? And that's going to be really important for an interview. All right, I'm now going to turn it over to Kim, who's going to talk about law enforcement-specific interviews.
Hey, sitting here listening to Alex, he has got such a grasp of how to do these interviews and how important it is that we realize how difficult it is for these victims to relive these stories of their assaults to us. And I really, just sitting here listening to them, I've really enjoyed it. I hope you all have too. So looking at this picture, I see so many things wrong. The victim's on the ground. There's three police officers towering over the top of her. And, that's not a good place to interview, get that thing started. So as law enforcement, what can we do? So we have our initial report. We actively listen. We ask questions to clarify. And really important that we withhold judgment. As far as the investigation goes, you want to follow your evidence. You don't want to use your gut feelings or, another case I worked, it was like this, so this case must be the same. You have to follow your evidence. So you really need to utilize your advocates, your victim service people, It really takes a village to investigate a case like this thoroughly. You know, you have the police aspect, you have this sane nurse or safe nurse aspect, and then you have grand jury, trial, district attorney. So it's really important that you utilize your advocates, whether it be from Safe Place or if you have victim services at your department. So as a first responder, the first contact that law enforcement has with a victim can really, really influence the direction of the investigation. Not too long ago, I heard about a case where the victim actually jumped out of a two-story window nude, made an outcry to a neighbor who, quite honestly, really did not want to get involved and call 911, but they did. And the first responder was really probably didn't believe what the victim was saying. And the victim did state that somebody had broken in and sexually assaulted her and raped her and beat her and really did horrible, horrible things. In fact, she was actually trying to protect her boyfriend who had done all these things. And the officer pretty much told her, hey, you're lying, and I know you're lying, and I'll take you to jail. Instead of kind of stepping back and trying to realize, just obviously looking at the victim, she had been, something horrible had happened to her. And it's so common that the victims do report, delay reports, and sometimes change their story because they're protecting the people that they love, that they trust, that they live with, that they care for, and quite honestly, do everything for. So many times, you really, really have to watch what you say because it really will influence the direction of the investigation. So a successful interview gains the evidence and information to prosecute your case, but it causes no additional harm to the victim. So your first responder. Now, I realize at Austin PD, we have detectives that are work these cases. We get called in from home at night. But there are some agencies that I've dealt with that they are the first responder, they are the detective and the investigator, and they do it all. And sometimes they don't have crisis available to call. And so they truly, truly have to step up and be everything for that victim until they can get assistance from a local advocate or somebody within in the department. So you need to make sure that your victim's physical needs are met immediately. If that means calling EMS, getting her to the hospital, then that's where you need to start. So the physical needs, emergency medical needs, and then your emotional needs. So you need to evaluate the scene for safety, witnesses, and physical evidence. Because once that physical evidence walks away or gets destroyed, it's pretty much gone forever. So make sure you secure your crime scene, identify your witnesses, identify anybody that you think may have any kind of information, and, of course, contact the detective or investigator who's going to be working the case. Really important for you to remember that your victim is a crime scene, your suspect is a crime scene, and then the actual location, which many times there are more than one of the actual assault. So once that stuff walks away, it's gone forever. So really important that you figure out quickly where it happened, how it happened. And then, again, your victim and your suspect are your crime scene too. Okay. So like Alex talked about, it's so important that you build that trust and rapport of your victims. So many are a vulnerable population, and so many times they don't really have a good relationship with law enforcement. For whatever reason, they're runaways, they are engaged in some sort of illegal activity, or they're immigrants, where they come from, law enforcement is corrupt and certainly not there to help. So really important that you develop that trust and rapport right away. Take those glasses off and allow them to be comfortable in the setting that you are in. Ask the victim how they're feeling. It's okay to say things like, I'm sorry this happened to you. This was not your fault. You know, we're going to do everything that in our power that we can do to help you today. You know, let's get you some emergency medical treatment. But try and make that victim comfortable and then build that trust. I believe you is really the most important thing that you can tell them, because that's what they're there for. They're there to make a statement, or I'm sorry, to give the information, and it's really important that they from the get-go understand that you believe them. So your initial report, you're going to gather information to determine if you have the elements of a crime, if they've been met, and exactly how that happened. Document what the victim was experiencing before, during, and after the assault. Alex talked about the sensory data. And document the victim's appearance and emotional condition as you observe them. If they have grass in their hair, you need to document that. If they have scratches, dirt under their fingernails, that all needs to be documented, because you know, that's going to assist in the investigation. So many times, though, these cases are delayed reporting, and it's just really important that when you do have that kind of that sort of thing, that you document it. Gaps are going to be really normal. It's normal that victims cannot recall complete details of the incident. Again, delay reporting is so common these days that it's not, doesn't mean that they're not telling the truth. It just means that for whatever reason they weren't able to come forward immediately. Again, most of the people that are sexually assaulting the victims are, you know, their partners and their friends and their boyfriends and their neighbors and their coworkers. And they're people that the victim trusted and may be living with or working next to every day. And again, those are all reasons why people don't report. Be sure that you ask the victim what was happening before the offense, after, and you know, get all the details that you can. Explain your decisions based on the evidence and information that you find in during the investigation, not your personal beliefs about what happened. Everybody reacts differently in these cases, and no response is typical. Many times I would have a victim, you know, they may cry, they may be matter of fact. Everybody reacts differently. And we're not the ones to judge how a person should react when they make a sexual assault report. Whenever you ask about the history of family violence, make sure that you ask the victim if indeed sexual violence has ever occurred. Violence doesn't stop at the bedroom door. It's really common that if the suspect is a victim of violence, that somehow, some way, sexual violence is included in there. And again, that's another reason why victim services should be called in. Many times I would get a phone call from a boyfriend or a husband of a victim, you know, asking me, how do I deal with my wife, or how do I deal with my girlfriend now? And quite honestly, those are questions that, you know, I didn't really feel comfortable answering, and that's why it was so important that I let my victim services person be involved in every aspect of the case. That's when, you know, they can step up and help the victim's family or the victim's partner when I can focus on the criminal aspect of the case. So your interview, sometimes you're just going to have to interview the victim immediately, right after the report has been made, especially if you have a suspect in custody or you feel like your victim is possibly not going to be around in a couple of days. So certainly take the victim's interview or statement at that time, but it's really recommended that you wait about 48 hours to interview that victim. Let them go home, you know, take their showers after their SANE exams, eat, relax, and get some sleep so that when they do come in, you know, that 2 days later, they can actually think about the things that have happened to them and they can express them in a way that, you know, assists their case. When interviewing your victims, it's really important, again, to bear in mind that each victim will respond differently. And refrain from judging the victim or applying your own sense of morality. People these days do many different things, and you are not the one to decide what they should or shouldn't be doing. And we had crazy cases that came from Craigslist. People would, you know, meet people on Craigslist and, you know, ask for different things. And it's not, you know, it's not your job to decide, you know, what they do or don't do is moral or right. You are merely there to try and determine if a crime occurred and then go from there. Again, you know, don't judge your victim on the actions that they took. You need to decide. You need to get the information, the evidence that leads you, you know, to investigate the case and so keep, you know, no gut feelings, keep an open mind and get the information to determine if a crime was committed or not. So the victim is going to recall things in a disorganized way. You know that. When I think back, when I retired in 2010, we did not have this information. And I think back about some cases that I, you know, investigated, and all these things about now really make sense. The disorganized way and, you know, how the trauma affects the brain. And even though a victim may have come in and give you a statement, all the evidence may lead you to believe that a crime was committed, sometimes a victim just won't want to press charges. And that's going to be up to each and every individual victim. I had a victim, an elderly woman that lived in an independent care facility, that she was a victim of a sexual assault. We went out and talked to her. It was actually a care worker at the facility was trying to help her take a shower, and he sexually assaulted her during that time. And she wanted to make a report, and she wanted to go to the hospital. But no matter what I said to her that day, she would not press charges. And, you know, after I went home that night and thought about it, I realized that no matter how badly I wanted her to press charges, this was up to her. And it kind of goes back to nobody is going to act the same. You know, everybody's going to act differently. Everybody has things, reasons why they report or don't report, press charges or don't press charges, because everybody's different. So when you're interviewing them, you know, allow the victim to talk without being interrupted. Let them know that you're actively listening. Again, it's okay to say, hey, I'm sorry this happened, and I believe you. As law enforcement, we like to ask the who, what, where, when, and how questions, and we need to remember that victims don't process the same way. Sure, they've seen lots and lots of television shows, and they think they know how it works, but in all truth and honesty, that's not really how it works. It doesn't all get taken care of in an hour or 2 hours, and it is a lengthy, long process. And it's okay if you explain that process to them because they truly don't know. Make sure you ask simple, genuine questions and let them tell their experience. Again, tell me about your experience and what happened. Ask open-ended questions. And if your victim gets off subject, you know, sometimes it's okay. Just let them talk about what they want to talk about. Eventually, you may have to guide them back to the story, but sometimes they will go off on something totally you think doesn't matter, but in the end, it may matter, you know? So just let them tell their story. And in the end, I always like to ask a victim, is there anything that you can think of that I have not asked that you think is important? So many times they would, you know, just come up with some little tidbit of information that I never thought to ask about this case because, again, every case is different. Another thing I try to tell every victim is to get out a notepad, carry it with them everywhere that they go with a pen. And sometimes at night they would wake up and think about things, and I would have them, you know, just tell them, hey, write it down on your notepad, call me in the morning. It's important that you give them the case number, you give them your name, victim services name, phone numbers that they can contact, because they truly, they're out of their element. This is your world, and they've only come into it because something really bad has happened to them, and to enable them to have a better experience, to make you more human to them, and to help them get through this without re-traumatizing the victims. You know, these are some things that hopefully you find helpful in your investigation, whether you be law enforcement or an advocate in some way.
Yeah, and I just think if I can add to that, you know, victim services is a great tool if you have that at your department because they're trained in this. And here's the thing. Once again, they make the victim feel comfortable and they feel safe and gain trust. And that's a great, great thing to accomplish. But on the flip side, the victim services is not something you just pawn your victim to. And I think we see that sometimes where law enforcement just says, I'll go talk to victim services and, you know, pass them off. So it is a tool to use, but you got to use it correctly. Here are resources. Actually, a couple of great books if you're interested. The Art of Human Hacking, it's great. It goes over all different aspects of interviewing. And then the other one is... police response to crimes of sexual assault, and just some website. If you have a question, go ahead and type it into the chat box, and we'll go ahead and answer it. But while we're waiting for that, I just want to thank everybody for attending. You know, Kim and I really have a lot of fun doing these presentations, and the webinar is a great tool to get this information out to people who might not have access to it. And this really is one of those things. This is a graduate level skill to have, is conducting an interview with a sexual assault victim. And with the information we have, it is something to practice, something to know, and the more you know, the better you're going to be at it. It's really requires a professional. Okay, question about the certificates. Certificates will automatically be emailed out after this course, hour, I think. If you need CEUs, email us at webinars@taasa.org. Also, if you want CEUs, you must have attended for 60 minutes and you must do the evaluation. The evaluation is going to be sent in the follow-up email. All right, let me see here. Yeah, we can definitely provide the PowerPoint. It should be automatically emailed out. If it's not, go ahead and let us know. And if you'd like to contact Kim or I, Kim, her email address is kfarbo, K-F-A-R-B-O, at taasa.org. And mine is aperotti, A-P-E-R-O-T-T-I, at taasa.org. Okay, I see there's some questions on interviewing children. That's a whole different ball game. And the main thing is we do like basic style training for the Child Advocacy Center, but really they're the trained professionals in how to interview children.
Yeah, that's a place that luckily I never had to go to as far as children go. It's a whole nother beast. If you need help, we could probably get a hold of somebody at Safe Place or Child Advocacy Center and forward you some information, but we are probably not the best people to help with that.
Yeah, we can definitely guide you if you shoot us an email. We can probably get you connected with somebody in your area that can best assist in that. It's such a specific thing of interviewing children, and so we don't want to say that we can attempt that. It's its own thing. Also saw somebody wants to look at the resources. We'll go back to resources. Here's a couple of books. The Art of Human Hacking is a good one. I don't know if I put one on here. There is also you can order off of Amazon. Like we said, you got to take the body language books. You got to be careful with, because, like I said, for interviewing sexual assault victims, a lot of it doesn't apply. And a good book will tell you that. But just a general good book. There's a book called "What Every Body Is Saying" by Joe Navarro, and he's an ex-FBI agent, and he has a whole aspect on different ways of sitting, how to conduct an interview, and has a lot of pictures in it. To demonstrate some things. You know, the basic police interviewing and interrogation guides, a lot of them don't include anything about sexual assault victims. But Amazon's got a whole reading section on different aspects of that. Do that. But there's the resources. All right, if you are attending this webinar and it was registered under a different name and you attended, and you need a certificate, see, the corporal needs a certificate, go ahead and email us at webinars@taasa.org and just tell us your situation and we'll make sure you get a certificate. I'll go ahead and type in our email here real quick. Okay. I don't see any other questions. If anybody has another question, any upcoming conferences? Yeah. Let's see. You're going to have to Google specifically what dates and everything, but Every Victim, Every Time, that goes on at College Station. That is a great law enforcement specific conference, and it's really inexpensive. It has a lot of great courses. I'm doing one on transnational organized crime, specifically looking at international human trafficking and human trafficking here in Texas. Heads up, the TAASA, we are hosting the National Sexual Assault Conference from June 7th to 10th, and that's going to be located in Dallas. Go ahead and check out our website. We have a lot of great speakers coming in for that conference. Yeah, other than that, I can't think of another conference that's coming up. So if there's any other questions. Oh, yeah, the Conference on Crimes Against Women is May 22nd to the 25th, and it's going to be in Dallas. There's also going to be the Crimes Against Children Conference. I think that's June. No, it might be May. And then the Champions of Children Conference is going to be happening in March in Amarillo. I'll type in the CEU web email address.
The Conference on Crimes Against Women, really, I read through the booklet, and it has some phenomenal speakers. You might want to look at that. But it's just before we have our TAASA conference. So you could just plan 2 weeks in Dallas. Join us for all of them.
Yeah. If you come to the National Sexual Assault Conference, it's going to be at the Anatole, and they got a pretty impressive pool, lazy river, swim-up bar. So it's a pretty cool location. All right. I don't see any other questions. I'll wait around for a minute or so, see if anybody's got any other questions. You know, we're here as a resource. If you need anything from us, please let us know. Reach out to us. You know, if this is some training you want for your department, send us an email. We can come out. We offer a whole series on law enforcement, interviewing. We're working on a forensics one through the Texas County or Travis County Sheriff's Office. And we just have an array of different trainings. Do we all come to San Antonio? Absolutely. Just let us know. We do technical assistance, and we can come down and do a class. Just send me an email, and we'll go ahead and coordinate that. Scholarships for the conference in Dallas through TAASA. There is, through our diversity task force, and there's a process for it, but you can go to our website and check it out. I don't know all the specific details, but I know that we do scholarships.
If you can't find that information on the website, shoot Alex or I an email, and we will try and help you to decide or figure out who can help you with that.
I see that you're starting victim services in El Paso. Some advice. You know, we want to come out to El Paso, absolutely. So if you go ahead and send me an email and tell us exactly if you want probably maybe classes and some technical assistance and guidance and a connection to resources, we can absolutely help with that. Just send me an email, and we'll set up a time, and we can fly out there for sure. Everything we do is free of charge, so all you have to do is let us know. We'll coordinate that, and we can definitely come down and assist you. All right. Any final questions? All right. Looks like that's about it as far as questions. Thank you very much for attending. Please reach out to us if you need any assistance. And please fill out that evaluation. That lets Kim and I know exactly how we're doing. Appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
of yours was true. Now do I think it back? Do I think it back? This time I really mean it, girl. Oh! Ten times in the world, I'm not out here.